Okay, our next speaker is Professor Alice Bell, who is a professor and former chairman of the Department of Chemical Engineering at the University of California, Berkeley. He obtained his BS and PhD from MIT in 1967. Alex has been very active in various aspects of catalytic science. He has been chairman of an NRC panel, which was focused at new directions in catalytic science and technology. Some of you no doubt have seen the book that his committee published on catalysis looks to the future. Today, Alex will talk to us about industry-university collaborations. What can we expect?
Thank you, John, for the introduction. It's a pleasure to participate in this panel discussion and symposium on interactions between industry, government, and universities. Let me start off by mentioning that the concept of an interaction between these three bodies is not a new one within the U.S. I can recall discussions going back probably 15 years or more within the chemistry and chemical engineering communities, suggesting that these three composite pieces of the research pie should interact more closely. And in fact, if you look at what has happened, we have the formation of the Council on Chemical Research in about 1979 that has fostered relationships between industry and academia. It's an ongoing activity which is highly successful. Then more recently, the National Research Council has published a series of reports, each of which in a different context has advocated this kind of closer collaboration between the industry and academia. The first of these being the Pimentel report, talking about the frontiers in chemistry. A few years later, a similar report on frontiers in chemical engineering. And most recently, last year, as was already mentioned by John Armour, we had the NRC report, which was specific to catalysis, called Catalysis Looks to the Future. In each of these reports, there is a strong recommendation that industry and universities work more closely together towards the national welfare. And the last of these, of course, emphasizes catalysis. Now, what I'd like to do is to talk a little bit about the motivation and why we should be making closer contacts between academic researchers and industrial researchers. I'd like to spend the most of my time, though, talking about what it takes to make this happen and what is involved, what expectations should each party have of the other, and finally to give you a few examples based upon my own experience. Let me start with this first transparency. It's obvious that interactions between industry and academia can lead to benefits for both parties. I'll illustrate that in just a moment. The next point is that the key to success is in defining reasonable goals and expectations. If one starts off on the wrong foot, has different expectations on each side of the fence, then one can anticipate that something less than full success will follow. And finally, the greatest success comes when these relationships can be cultivated over a long period of time, long being measured in units of 5 years, so 5, 10, 15 years and more, and then a true understanding of each other's capabilities, needs, etc., can be established, and this can work to mutual benefit. So let's see what are the motivations. I've categorized these in terms of motivations for industry and motivations for academic researchers. The motivations for industry, at least within the American context, are that economic constraints are making it harder and harder for industrial laboratories to carry out what we would call long-term fundamental research. This is research that is pertinent to the goals of the industry, but transcends an immediate product or process need, or the need to meet certain environmental regulations that have been imposed. There's a recognition, though, that there's a need for fundamental information. Input. How to achieve that? One way is to develop closer working relationships with university laboratories. Such relationships, fostered and nurtured, can provide information, research. before they appear in the journals and other publications. They can lead to familiarity with computational and experimental techniques that are being developed and emerging from academic laboratories, again, before they are widely disseminated and widely known. It also provides a mechanism for the industrial partners to teach and make aware the academic partners of what are the needs of industry, what are the long-term research areas that are pertinent to advancing a given area, particularly catalysis. Now, from the academic standpoint, there are also strong motivations. First of all, by working with an industrial partner, you get to understand specifically and firsthand what are the needs of industry, what needs to happen, what kind of materials does one need to know about, what are the technical issues, and how can fundamental research come about that. The second bullet there, of course, is the obvious one, that if things are working well, there are opportunities to receive funding from industry, and that can then complement the major part of the funding, which comes still from government agencies, principally from the Department of Energy and the National Science Foundation, where catalysis is concerned. Now, how do you initiate such interactions between academia and industry? I illustrated here several possibilities. The first, of course, is consulting agreements. Many of us in academia do consult for industry, and over time, we get to know our technical partners. Through these contacts, we identify issues that transcend specific products and processes, and therefore become appropriate themes for research to be carried on within the university. Another way to get to know industry and its problems is to spend a sabbatical in industry. It's not unheard of. In my own case, in 1983, I spent part of a semester at Exxon Research in New Jersey. It was very fruitful. I learned a lot about Raman spectroscopy, dispersed metal oxides, and how these are relevant to problems that are carried out in industry. I might mention that one of my young colleagues has spent a similar sabbatical at IBM laboratories, although not in the field of catalysis. He learned a considerable amount about polymers as they apply to the electronics industry. This has nucleated the whole new research venture for him. The other possibility, of course, is that an industrial partner spends a sabbatical at a university. This is, of course, much more rare, but I'll give you an example of a case from my own history a little bit later in this talk. This gives the opportunity, though, for the industrial individual to see what goes on in academic laboratories, what are the constraints, what are the capabilities, and how can an academic laboratory work successfully with an industrial collaborator. The last bullet here is one that you might not hear of very often, but industry can take the initiative. I know of at least three examples where, not in catalysis, but in other areas of chemistry, an industrial partner has said, I'm putting forward so much money to support research in academic institutions. It will be on themes, general themes that I define that are relevant to my business, and I will invite proposals from the academic sector. And in one case, I know this was to support a fellowship, and in the other two cases I'm aware of, this was to support general grants for research, and again, provided a very good mechanism for having a working relationship with the industrial partner. Now, getting started requires getting to know each other. It's like any human relationship. You get to know each other before you have a working relationship. And there's a need to develop a realistic understanding of each other's capabilities and what to expect from each other. So here I've identified, first of all, for the academic partner, there's a need to recognize that industry is in need of information that will accelerate the development of its products and processes. There's a statement that I have heard several times now from industrial people, which is that fundamental knowledge is good, intrinsically good, but it's of no value to industry unless it gives that industry a competitive edge. So knowledge needs to be defined in areas that are appropriate to advancing Finally, academic partners must understand the need to communicate the results of their work they're going to do with an industrial partner. And this has to be done in a timely fashion. That means quarterly reports, annual reports, visits back and forth to the industrial partner. On the other side, the industrial partner needs to understand the constraints and limitations of what happens in academia. The principal function of academic institutions is to provide an education to young people who are going to receive a doctoral degree, and those who already hold a doctoral degree who are doing postdoctoral educational training. And so the leaders of academic research are looking for problems that have significant intellectual content and which advance the frontiers of knowledge within their field. And so it's appropriate to seek that kind of problem for collaborative research, rather than a problem that is of intense short-term interest to industry, but might not be appropriate for, say, a doctoral research problem. And finally, I'd like to stress that while a certain amount of materials testing, catalyst testing, might be appropriate within an academic laboratory, this is not the most efficient use of academic talent, and is probably not the most appropriate use to do routine analysis and testing. Well, let's assume that everything is going smoothly and that the initial contacts are made. How do we define a meaningful collaboration? Here I've listed a number of points. The first, I think, is to define an area of long-term, i.e. enduring importance to both industry and the academic partner, and to articulate specific areas of research and what are the requirements. The next is to define specific objectives for the near term and a reasonable time scale on which research results can be delivered. Third, there's a need to agree on the mechanisms for exchange of information and data in a timely fashion. And fourth, there's a need to agree on what it's going to cost. The best way to support research in an academic institution is to pay the full cost of, say, one or two students or one postdoc or whatever is appropriate for the objectives. It's hard on the academic partner when the level of support covers one-third, one-half, two-thirds of a human individual. Invariably, this puts great stress and strain because finding the missing one-third, one-half, whatever it is, means that you have to break certain rules and regulations, or you go to your department chairman and beg. And these days, department chairmen turn out their pockets and say, we have problems too. As I said earlier, there's a need to exchange information between the academic and industrial partners in a collaborative venture. This takes the form of quarterly and annual reports, written visits, to make oral presentations on the part of the academic researcher and the industrial laboratory. And also, it's important that the visits occur in the reverse direction so that the industrial partner can see firsthand who is working on their project and have an opportunity to interact with this individual or individuals. These visits serve the purpose not only of exchanging information, but also offer an opportunity for redefining the goals, sharpening the directions, and asking, are the original problems and objectives that we set out whatever months back still the ones that we want to pursue? There's always time to redefine focus. Now, in the abstract, I promised to give you a few personal examples. I'd like to do this because each one of these examples is qualitatively different in terms of the nature of the arrangement, whether or not money crossed the boundaries between academia and industry. Now, I think it illustrates the large range of possibilities that exist. The first and most long-standing arrangement that I have is with W.R. Grace. In fact, it's with our next speaker, Louis Hegedus, who has facilitated this. The theme has changed over the 6+ years that we've been engaged in this venture. The initial 3 years or so were devoted to fundamental aspects of zeolite synthesis, and more recently it has been devoted to fusion of large molecules in zeolites. The origin of this collaboration has been my consulting for W.R. Grace, which goes back nearly 12 years, and has given me an opportunity to see firsthand what happens in a large industrial organization that is devoted to catalyst manufacturing. And out of this have come themes, these two themes, that are of mutual interest and have resulted in a grant to our university. And in this case, the actual support is in the form of a grant with all the usual contractual obligations. The second example is with mobile research, and this was a one-time, short-term arrangement. It took place about 4 years ago. At the time, Clarence Chang came to visit me for mobile. And Clarence had just been promoted to corporate scientist, which meant that he was fairly free to undertake whatever research he felt was interesting. And I suggested to him that perhaps perhaps he would like to initiate this new post by taking a short academic sabbatical, or sabbatical from industry. And we agreed that that might be interesting to do in the area of zeolite synthesis, with a particular focus on the use of NMR spectroscopy to look at the issues attending zeolite synthesis. His management agreed that this would be useful. They agreed to pay his salary for 7 months, sent him and his family out to the West Coast, and they provided us with a small grant to help support the cost. This was a non-overhead gift, not going to get past the overhead regulations of the university. Well, this was very intense, very successful venture. Clarence worked closely with two of my graduate students, taught them quite a bit about zeolite synthesis from an industrial perspective, and we learned even more from him. The outcome of this work was one publication, not bad for 7 months of effort, and it has also placed the seeds for the work of a new doctoral student who is currently in the second year of his effort. In this case, little money crossed the boundaries between Mobile and Berkeley. It was just enough to pay for the supplies and expenses consumed during the 7 month event. And there were no contractual agreements. In fact, Vern Wiegman, who is Clarence's boss, said, "Clarence, go out there, but please don't invent anything while you're out there, because that will certainly complicate matters for us." And Clarence tried hard not to invent. He's a very inventive person. The third and last example here concerns Kodak. This is the corporate research laboratories, where I've had, I believe it's about a 7+ years collaborative interaction with Evgeny Shostorovich. And again, this, in this case, is an outcome of my consulting for Kodak and their catalysis group. And through that contact, I met Evgeny Shostorovich, discovered shortly after that that he was working on a new theory called Bomberg Conservation Force Potential Approach, an homological approach, for calculating heats of absorption for molecules and molecular fragments on other surfaces, and also a complementary method for calculating the activation energies for elementary processes. And I got excited about this. We then, on a later visit, agreed that we could collaborate in this area, and this started a six-year adventure for us in which we talked on the phone, we exchanged pieces of paper about facts and other means, and this all led to a series of 8+ publications over this 6-year period. In this case, the management at Kodak agreed that the collaboration was a worthwhile thing and in their interest, and allowed Dr. Shostorovich to spend a certain fraction of his time on the collaboration. But no other monies cast hands. There was no grant to Berkeley in this case. Nevertheless, this was a very successful collaboration and also stimulated the work of one of my PhD students. So here's another example in which the contact with an industrial laboratory has fed directly into the academic mission. So I've given you several examples. I've talked to you about what it takes to have a successful interaction. And what I'd like to leave you with is that there is a large realm of opportunity here academic collaboration. It needs to be approached carefully. One has to cultivate the contacts. One needs to then establish a sense of what is expected on both sides and what each partner is capable of delivering. There are various ways to play the game. Money can pass hands, but it doesn't have to. People can cross the boundary, but that doesn't have to happen. You can even do it with mirrors or by wires or however you wish to do it at a very long distance, as we've done with Kodak. It's largely been done by email and faxes. The point is that it can be done and should be encouraged. And I would hope that in the future we'll see more such collaborations. I think it holds a lot of promise for the field of analysis. Thank you very much.
Take one question, and again, we'll handle the rest during the panel discussion.
Yes, Ken Hoffman from Northwestern. Your title was Industry Academic Interactions, and you focused on the individual investigator in the university relating with industry,
right.
Both sort of on an individualistic way and also as industry in general. But what about the role of this industry academic from the point of view of the university more broadly? Aren't there very large issues there, and is that an important component to having a successful industry academic policy or relationships? Or is it only through the individual investigator?